This is the AN-602, also known as the Tsar Bomba, the most powerful bomb ever detonated. Built by Soviet engineers at the height of the Cold War, the Tsar Bomba had a destructive yield of 50 megatons of TNT, unmatched by any other bomb ever created. In this video, we'll break it down in detail and explore whether it was practical as a weapon and could have tipped the balance of the arms race. In this film, we'll focus on the Tsar Bomba's test, from loading onto the carrier to explosion and its aftermath. My name is David Webb, and this is Blue Paw Print. The Tsar Bomba was an aerial hydrogen bomb, 6.9 feet in diameter and 26 feet long, just about the length of a classic London double-decker bus. It weighed around 54,000 pounds. The casing of the bomb was made from steel, lined with beryllium. It covered a synthetic fiber thermoinsulation layer, installed to keep sensitive explosives and nuclear materials within a stable temperature range. At the tip of the bomb was a control module, enclosed in a protective casing. This module was connected to two protruding radio rangefinder antennas and barometric sensors. The tail section of the bomb featured three fixed fins for aerodynamic stability on release and a rear compartment for a multi-stage parachute pack. To understand how the Tsar Bomba worked, we're going to take you through its launch sequence. The carrier that delivered the Tsar Bomba to the test site was the Tupolev Tu-95V, a heavy modified version of the Soviet four-engine turboprop strategic bomber Tu-95. To fit the Tsar Bomba, the bomb bay of the Tu-95V was substantially enlarged. It was widened to 5.8 feet, and its length was increased to 23.45 feet. To mount the bomb, a specialized beam-type bomb rack was installed directly to the load-bearing beams of the aircraft structure. Two internal fuel tanks were removed, and a transverse bulkhead was relocated, allowing more space for the bomb bay. The machine guns in the Tu-95V's tail turret were removed. In their place, sensor probes were installed to measure the thermal and shockwave impulses. The plane was coated in a special white reflective paint to protect it from intense thermal radiation and the heat of the explosion. Once the bomb was carefully hoisted into the enlarged bomb bay and multiple ground checks were performed, the Tu-95V received clearance for takeoff. Even with all the modifications made to the aircraft, the Tsar Bomba had to be carried semi-externally. The plane lifted off from the runway of the Alenia Air Base, a major Russian Navy reconnaissance base, located on the Kola Peninsula, 92 kilometers south of Murmansk. It then climbed to 6 miles and headed towards the target. The test site where the Tsar Bomba was released was officially designated the State Test Site No. 6 of the Ministry of Defense. It was located on Novaya Zemlya, an archipelago in northern Russia situated in the Arctic Ocean. It covered more than 21,000 square miles of land and 14,500 square miles of surrounding water. Zone S of the test site, chosen for the explosion, was just 9 miles north of Mityushchika Bay. The nearest settlement, Siverny, was 34 miles away, presumed to be at a safe distance, even though its population had been evacuated. At 11:32 a.m. on October the 30th, 1961, the Tu-95V bomber was over the test site and released the bomb. After the bomb was dropped, the parachute system activated. A massive cargo parachute system, weighing nearly 4,000 pounds, was housed in a round compartment at the rear section of the bomb, and it consisted of 9 parachutes. The sequence began with a small 5.4 square feet drogue chute, which pulled out a larger 54 square feet parachute. Next came 3 parachutes of 65 square feet each, followed by three more, each measuring 430 square feet. Once a series of smaller parachutes have stabilized the descent, the main canopy unfurled. At over 17,000 square feet, its area was three times the area of a Boeing 747's wings. It was one of the largest single parachute canopies ever used. The parachute system slowed the bomb's fall for a total of 188 seconds. It gave the pilots time to fly to a safer distance of approximately 28 miles before the explosion. The Tsar Bomba detonation altitude was 13,000 feet above the ground. This was the height estimated by the Soviet scientists to provide the maximum explosive damage while reducing fallout. The radio altimeter transmitted a signal to the ground and then measured the distance from the reflected signal. Its readings were verified by barometric sensors. If the data matched, the safety devices were deactivated. The primary fission charge was made from two spheres located in the weapon's fore and rear sections. Each sphere consisted of a shell of high-performance explosives with detonators, a beryllium inner casing, and a plutonium sphere around 4 to 6 inches in diameter at the core. A system of gas-filled spark gaps was connected to high-voltage capacitors, which were charged by a battery pack. When triggered, each spark gap closed to pass very large currents instantaneously, ensuring the detonators fired within 0.1 microseconds of each other. In that time, light would travel just 98 feet. A spherical shell of high-performance explosives, presumably octol, a mixture of octogen and TNT, exploded, creating a shockwave and causing compression inside the core. Once the plutonium had been compressed, it went supercritical and would start emitting vast amounts of neutrons. A neutron striking a plutonium nucleus caused it to split into two smaller nuclei, releasing energy and emitting additional neutrons. These neutrons went on to split other plutonium nuclei, launching a chain reaction. The beryllium inner casing reflected the neutrons back into the core, therefore increasing the efficiency of the primary stage and producing a stronger initial blast. The fission process generated an enormous amount of heat, reaching temperatures of 100 million degrees Celsius, several times higher than the core of the Sun. It released a massive pulse of high-energy gamma rays and X-rays, which was then used to trigger the secondary stage of the explosion. The second charge consisted of a lead outer casing, a layer of lithium deuteride, which was a compound of lithium, and the fusion fuel deuterium, and a plutonium rod in the center. The plutonium rod was compressed and subject to a barrage of neutrons released during the first stage. It made it turn supercritical to produce more neutrons. Lithium deuteride absorbed the neutrons and produced tritium, a radioactive isotope of hydrogen. Under extreme temperatures and pressures, deuterium and tritium nuclei collided and fused to form helium, producing an enormous amount of energy. The lead cylindrical casing acted as a tamper, holding the materials inside long enough for the fusion reaction to develop. The original Tsar Bomba design had a cylindrical casing made of depleted uranium, but for test purposes, lead engineer Andrei Sakharov ordered it to be replaced with lead. This modification halved the bomb's yield from its designed 100 megatons to 50 megatons, but at the same time reduced the amount of potential radioactive fallout by nearly 97%, making it the cleanest nuclear bomb by megaton ever detonated. The entire series of nuclear reactions lasted only a fraction of a microsecond. The first thing to be seen was an extraordinary, intense flash of light. Witnesses described it as dazzling, brighter than the sun at noon, and lasting for more than a minute. It was followed by the fireball, expanding rapidly and reaching a diameter of nearly 5 miles, enough to cover downtown Los Angeles. The fireball nearly touched the ground. The only reason it didn't was that the shockwave from the initial blast bounced off the ground and hit the expanding fireball, causing the characteristic flattening seen in photographs. Had the fireball touched the ground, it would have created much greater radioactive fallout. The fireball transformed into a towering mushroom cloud that reached somewhere between 40 and 42 miles high, approximately 7 times higher than Mount Everest, and extending above the stratosphere. The top of the cloud spread out to about 59 miles wide, while the base measured around 25 miles across. The explosion created seismic effects equivalent to a magnitude 5 earthquake. The Tu-95V aircraft that dropped the bomb was reached by the blast even from over 60 miles away. The aircraft was shaken badly and reportedly lost altitude, yet regained control and landed safely. The protective white coating on the Tu-95V's fuselage sustained scorching and superficial burns. On the ground, the rocky surface of the island was reportedly leveled and turned to a black, dead 5-kilometer lake of melted earth. The 34 miles distant village of Severny, presumed to be at a safe distance, was completely destroyed. The violent tremor caused by the explosion could be felt nearly 560 miles away, including in Norway and in Finland. While the Tsar Bomba was the peak of nuclear development for the time, it was too heavy and too complex to be practical in warfare. It was exceptionally effective, though, as a political statement, but at the same time, a sobering reminder of humanity's capacity for destruction. As a result, both superpowers begin to reconsider the path of unlimited nuclear escalation. Within 2 years in 1963, the Partial Nuclear Test Ban Treaty was signed, prohibiting atmospheric nuclear tests. Ultimately, the Tsar Bomba helped push the world towards nuclear restraint, rather than nuclear annihilation. The Tsar Bomba was truly one of a kind, but if you'd like to find out about the first mass-produced long-range missile, please watch our video on the V2 rocket. This was a lot of work to dissect such a complex weapon, and given so much of the Tsar Bomba is still undisclosed. If you spot any errors, please let us know in the comments. Thank you.